traveling in 2020 and 2021 has taught me what talking to people with completely different stories can do to one's perspective of the world. After traveling to places like Pakistan or Bangladesh, where I met the Rohingya minority, I grew increasingly intrigued about how minorities live around the world, because this can provide unique outlooks on life. I discovered that these places are home to so many inspirational stories and to some of the most genuine and welcoming people in the world. Therefore, with an open mind and an open heart, I decided to embark on a new adventure, Iraqi Kurdistan. If you know something about this place, chances are you just heard one side of the story.
On my orders, coalition forces have begun striking selected targets of military importance to undermine Saddam Hussein's ability to wage war.
U.S. warships and planes launched the opening salvo of Operation Iraqi Freedom.
Tonight, the world's attention is absolutely fixed on Iraq.
This is the scene in central Baghdad.
We didn't find any weapons of mass destruction.
ISIL has claimed responsibility for the attack.
Their goal is to form an Islamist state ruled by Sharia law in parts of Iraq and
American
Syria.
American warplanes and special forces are backing thousands of Iraqi and Kurdish fighters. They are moving on Mosul.
Al-Baghdadi is dead.
However, I feel that what I hear on the news does not tell the whole story about this place. This land is home to some of the most ancient traditions on earth, and to the Kurds, who are the largest ethnic group without their own country in the world that expands throughout Syria, Turkey, Iraq, and Iran. This land is also home to the Yazidis, a religion that dates back millennia and is primarily found in the area surrounding their holy site of their religion, Lalish. Upon arrival, we just found curious people and kids with some of the cutest smiles I have ever seen. However, one cannot ignore the recent past these people have had to suffer. Unlike Christians and Jews, Yazidis are not mentioned in the Quran, so they were not always guaranteed the same rights as other minorities. When ISIS reached Sinjar, the largest Yazidi city in Iraq, in 2014, Yazidis were forced to flee walking through the desert with close to nothing for several days, until they reach the Kurdish region, where they have started a new life in refugee camps. I traveled to Lalish to dig deeper in their traditions and see how the aftermath of ISIS looks like 7 years later in 2021.
Yazidis people need this place. Yazidis is the soul of Yazidi people is here. Lalish. Why? Because all Yazidis make baptism one time in his life. He come to Lalish. And now, when I come to Lalish, I see some people, he say, I don't have father. I see some girls, the ISIS killed her fathers, her mothers, her sisters. This is a problem, not for me only if I'm happy. It's not good for only I'm happy. I need not Yazidi people, all people's happy. When there is some problem, in Germany, in Yemen, in any place, because Yazidis people will pray to the old peoples. We say the face to the sun. We say, I want all people be a good. I want all people live a good life, and the last one me. This is the prayer of Yazidis. We don't choose some groups. When there is any problem in any place, we be sad. Because we pray to all peoples. I am person. I don't ask from the religion. You are person. If you are good for me, I don't need the religion. If you are Christian, you are Jewish, you are Islam, you are Yazidi, you help me. This is the right way. If you are Islam, you are not good with me. If you don't have religion, you are good. For me, it's okay for me. Because the religion, I don't ask from the religion. I respected you because the God make you. This is in the text of Yazidi religion.
That's such like
I am here near to 12 years. All people come here, I respect him. I don't ask for the religion. I give him the lunch, I give him the dinner, I give him the breakfast, I help him. Some people come to stay, poor people stay in my house. One girl, she is from France, she come here, she make the book, she stay in my house 72 days. Yeah.
To write the book?
Yes. She tell me, what do you want? I tell him, I want you come again. She tell me, you are crazy? I tell me, yes, I'm crazy. I come to lunch every day with me. I give the money of the taxi. I give him the lunch, the dinner, the breakfast, 72 days. This is my message in the life. I come to help. Not everything's money.
What is the thing that makes you happy?
Make me happy when I help my community, actually. Before 1 month, I helped 10 women to know writing and speaking Arabic English, like a course.
Mm-hmm.
I was trainer. Yeah, that's why I was trainer and teach them, because I taught him, your son, your girl need you, not need me. Maybe need me, but need you right now to teach your kids.
What do people need to heal on an emotional level?
Need more of things. So the woman needs to take course, like psych therapist, you know.
Yes.
And teach all women at camps Arabic, English, because at Iraq, when we study English, just IBC. No one teach me to speak with different country, like when you coming in my camp, if I didn't explain my feeling, no one will explain my feeling. Yes, we have translation or translate, but they are can't explain my feeling, you know.
We have some people seek psychology.
Uh-huh.
After the ISIS come,
yeah.
Some people are afraid. Some people see when the ISIS killed her father and mother.
Yeah.
You know, all these people is sick, psychology sick.
Uh-huh.
Not we need some people give him something to eat.
No,
medicine. Only to talk with him.
Medicine,
yeah. Yes.
So you started studying psychology because you want to help people emotionally.
Yes, of course. When I came into camp, I say more of girls sick, so sick, need to help, to talk with them, to say don't be afraid, this year will be finished and we will be safe. No one will kill me or kill my brother, my sisters. So it's really a bad feel to say, oh my God, someone will come and kill me or kill my sisters or all my family. So they are need to talk with them, to say, don't be afraid and we will free.
But now if you go to the camp, you see the life of the camp. It's very, very bad. We have some child. He don't know there is house. He don't know there is house because he born in the camp. He born in the camp. When you go tell him, what's your house? You say, this is my house. The camp is house.
We are going to the camp after.
Is this a problem? And now you are here. The weather is 45 number. When you go to be in the camp, it's made of the nylon. I know near to 50 number. It's very, very hot. I know all people is unhappy. And you don't, there is no, how you change, you don't know. You go to Sinjar every day, the Turkish people's bombing. There is no school, there is no hospital, there is no work. no job. It's a problem. We have some in Germany, some people. But now he stay with his family. When you ask him, he say I'm sad. I want to come to Lalish. I want to come to my house.
The large population of Yazidis around the Sinjar mountains was severely reduced after the genocide, as 80% of the population fled completely to other regions in Iraqi Kurdistan or abroad, particularly Germany, which has an estimated Yazidi population of 200,000. As we were getting deeper into their way of life, I realized that most people in Lalish were either living in refugee camps or were visiting from Germany. Despite all the hardship these people have been through in life, I was left speechless after listening to their outlooks on life.
Just I have something like, I'm so positive, I have more energy to say, oh girl, be happy, no, nothing would happen with you after this thing. And say, just be happy because we are, at future will be happy, but at the moment I boxed, oh my god, no, I can't be happy because no one will help me to be happy. So say, I say, no, we will be happy also to say like this.
How have you managed to study while you were living in a tent? You have been living in a tent for how many years now?
You can say 7 or 8.
Seven or eight years,
yeah,
living in a tent.
Yeah.
Oh, and you have taught English yourself?
Yeah.
And you're studying psychology.
Yeah.
You're about to finish psychology.
Yeah.
How have you managed to do all of that by yourself?
And I will tell you other things. Right now I am studying other language, German language, right now. We have a course at camp. Because when you want something in your side, something pushes you to achieve that. So when I want something, first I pushed myself to achieve that, and then in my side something pushed me to achieve that. It is so easy. Yeah.
I know the people live one times. I come to this life one times. This is the philosophy of Yazidis. I not come to only to eat, and only to sleep. I come here to make something, to help the people, to make the camera, to make the television, to make the mobile. This is the message of the life. And now, if I don't change my life, I need help myself. But now, if I go to sit down here, I am sad. Who changed the weather for me? No, I change. I come here, I'm talking with you, I'm talking with this man, I go to eat with this man.
What is the key to have a happy life for you?
I don't know. Someone tell me that. Don't ask that this question. I don't know, actually.
How do you stay happy?
How I stay happy? Actually, when I was child, all the time I tell myself, just be happy. And all my life I just care about studying. So all times I feel happy, and who I watch, I mean when I saw someone, I told them, this life it's so short if you be happy, and so long if you be sad. So be happy all times.
After visiting Lalish, we moved to one of the many refugee camps scattered across the region to see the reality of many of the people we met in Lalish.
Back in 2014, before ISIS invaded Sinjar, like the place that I'm sitting in right now, it was just a flat field. And after the ISIS invasion, like of Sinjar, after they attacked Sinjar and controlled the whole city, this place became a big camp for more than 3,000 families. Not only in this place, but in many other areas in Kurdistan. Camps, they were supposed to be temporary, but now they're not. They have been staying in those camps for almost 9 years. The future of Yazidis who fled from Sinjar, I can say it's undefined until now. Because till now the city is destroyed, there is no services there. No one can go back to there because there is no safety. You know, the bombs are still there. So many other things. And so many militias are controlling the area, so there's no safety. That's why thousands of people aren't able to go back.
You should just restart your life and build it from zero. And this is the hardest part. And this is the human nature, you know, that that everyone should just keep up and keep on to continue his life. It was in August 3, when the ISIS just invaded our home area, which is Sinjar, and they started the camp in the midnight. There was a fighting till the morning, and there in the morning we see nothing but ISIS, and we fled out. They just asked people to pay or convert to Islam, or for Yazidis they would be killed even if they did those things. Even if they paid or convert to Islam, they would kill them, but they just keep the woman for themselves to sex trafficking and human trafficking. So for the slavery and those things, they just want people to live just on like their own way. Yeah, they want to own people, just to use them as slaves, especially women for sex slavery, and they use men just for. They also use men for slavery, but it takes us about 5 to 10 days to go out from our villages to go to Syria. And we use just our feet, and we had no vehicles to transport.
So you had to carry everything you had?
Yeah, we just, and we just, once we realized that ISIS would invade Sinjar by the fighting, we just fled out. And we hold nothing, even food we hadn't.
What were you carrying with you?
Just water.
What?
Just water and our documents, just like ID and passport, as if we had.
That's it. And you left everything else behind?
Yeah, everything we had. Everything we built, every our dreams, and just like this. Yeah, and it was just the hardest part, just to leave your home. And we felt that it would take days, and we would back to our homes. But you know, it's been 8 years since we here. And everyone, you can say that is hopeless now, and everyone is lost because it's been a long time. Just the little kids become younger people, and they just grow up in the tents, and this is a very bad condition for them. You know, this generation that that grow up in such a condition will be lost and hopeless, because you know the condition is too bad for them, and it's not adaptable for just you can say growing up a kid.
What were your main difficulties as a student when you were studying here in Dohuk and in Mosul as well.
Yeah, the hardest thing is I faced while I'm studying, it was transportation and studying in these tents, because I had to study, and the condition was not comfortable and suitable for studying here, because there was a noise of children and our family was big, so there was no space for studying, and I had no computers back then, and financially I was just suffering, because there was no money and we had no work back then. It was too hard.
Two weeks before we arrived, in June 2021, one of the many refugee camps was set on fire due to an electrical failure, burning almost 400 tents. This is just one of the many problems Yazidis have to face living under these conditions. Traveling to Iraqi Kurdistan showed me what it really means to be human. Perhaps to be human means to lose everything, to stumble, to cry, just to stand up and rebuild a new life again, no matter how hard or painful it might be. Being received in Lalish with a genuine smile taught me what the true nature of humanity is. One that is kind, compassionate, one that, I believe, can make the world a better place. One that can transform something painful into something beautiful, something to hold on to. From the ashes, we'll arise to build a better tomorrow, to live for another day.
Hi everyone, thanks so much for watching the video until here. I just wanted to mention that we have decided to partner with Saim's NGO, Paid NGO, to start a fundraiser and teach courses in a refugee camp in northern Iraq. And yeah, with your help, hopefully we will be able to teach some courses in these refugee camps. One of the courses is about psychology, and if you have watched the video until here, you have realized how important psychological support is for the Yazidis who have lost everything and have been living in refugee camps for 7 or 8 years now. So yeah, all details are going to be here in the description, and yeah, thanks so much for watching, and bye.